Hey guys, thanks for tuning in. Today I'm going to show you how to save some money replacing your secondary O2 sensors on your N54 powered BMW. So a bit of a backstory here. This is my MSD 80 ECU. I've recently upgraded to MSD 81 where they fixed some known issues. And I did that because I was hoping that maybe the issue lied with the ECU. Even though I changed the MOSFETs, I was getting some misfires up high. But what actually happened was I replaced this ECU, and right when I put the new one in, it told me that my secondary O2 sensors were bad. Okay, just as a disclaimer, I've already done the work. I replaced the secondary O2 sensors with universal sensors for maintenance. I'm chasing down some codes. Ended up being that replacing the sensors didn't resolve the codes. But there's a lot of valuable information in this video, as well as a bunch of theory and showing you how to replace the sensors and save yourself some money. So I'm putting it up anyway. I did end up resolving the issue by just swapping the connector on the ECU. Two of my wires were mixed up, pin 19 and pin 20. So there's some crosstalk. And for whatever reason, only an MSD 81 ECU will clearly tell you there's a problem. My other ECU wouldn't. It seems to happen often enough when people put in the DP fix. But we'll continue with the rest of this video. It's going to show you how to replace your PostCat O2 sensors with universal sensors and get into some theory. So for whatever reason, the LCI ECU was able to tell me, hey, by the way, one of your O2 sensors is bad, and that's throwing off your tune. So the secondary O2 sensors are calibrated for stoichiometric, and if they're not healthy, they can throw off the primary values. And a good way for you guys to relate to that is if you ever tried the downpipe fix, where you wire that in, if you leave that in long term, you'll throw off your fuel trims in the primary, and it can cause issues, misfires, etc., if you just left it like that. So these secondary O2 sensors have to be healthy for the primaries to work properly. They calibrate, they look for what is stoichiometric. From what I've read and understood, they can only reference proper stoichiometric from the secondaries, and then they calibrate the whole range from 0 to 5 volts primary. And a lot of people probably neglect their O2 sensors. It's just kind of strange that the MSD 80s, you couldn't tell me that my O2 sensor was bad when it was just a simple little thing for the MSD 81, but you know, it's part of the progress, I guess. It's one of the fixes. So as soon as I got that code, the car ran differently, and it actually started to pull like a beast and zero misfires, because I think it's just disregarding them and running off a base table just to get you by. But huge difference. So I'm going to show you guys how to replace your secondary O2 sensors, but these are universal sensors that are going to save you a ton of money, because why pay for all the custom wiring for this car when you just need the head? Let me show you what comes with this universal kit. Since this is a narrow band sensor, the actual head, this part of it, is the same as what's on your car for the secondary O2. Comes with a zip tie, instructions, and a little splice harness. And it comes with the four wires that you gotta strip and connect. But the reason you pay more money depending on which car you're dealing with is because they have sometimes shielding, they have different lengths, they have the connector, you know, it costs more. But if all you need is the head plus wiring, you can save a lot of money. These two sensors can be had for about $100 instead of spending at least $200 for the original Bosch sensors with the harness and everything ready to just insert on the car. So these are designed to read a perfect air fuel ratio. And on newer cars, there's two sets of O2s. There's the wide band, they call it, 0 to 5 volt. For more resolution primary, and then there's a secondary 0 to 1 volt. So this is really fine-tuned for when you're partial throttle cruising and you want a perfect stoichiometric value. So I guess the way the ECU is calibrated is it will look to this to see what is stoichiometric, and then it'll take that information and calibrate the secondary or the primary O2s, so they'll run between 0 and 5 volts, but they'll know, they'll have a base reference, they'll understand, okay, reference the secondary O2 to find out when we're stoichiometric, and then I'll use that as like the middle point of the wide band to actually run properly. So if you put the downpipe fix on the ECU, it actually plays around with these sensor values. And if you leave that over time, your wide band like this is just kind of a weird analogy, but imagine this is the band, 5 volts, 0 volts. So this is your wide band, but this has actually got a narrow band. It's a narrow band O2 sensor, but it's gonna do a much better job of reading between that narrow band and telling you the perfect middle point than a wide band would be able to, because it's looking for the wide range. So hopefully that makes sense. So where do you know what's up and what's down? Check with the secondary O2s to know what's up and what's down. If your secondary O2s are bad, what's up and what's down may shift. From what I've read and seen, if people delete these off their car, then it drifts toward rich and it can cause you issues. So you can't neglect these. So when you have a wideband O2 sensor, it's a wider range and you can really, while flooring it and being under load, watch if the AFRs are good. So if you're under full power floored, it will actually know exactly how much air and fuel is happening and your car will be calibrated properly. This is a narrow band and all it's looking for is stoichiometric. Old cars used to have only narrow bands and all they could tell you is if your partial throttle cruising air fuel ratio was perfect so that you'll get better fuel economy. But as soon as you floor it, you're out of the range that it can tell you where the air fuel ratio is. And it would just disregard the sensor and run to a base table that's in your ECU. It would go into what's called open loop mode, where it's disregarding the sensor and just going off a chart that's built into the ECU to reference, okay, how much fuel should I add? Let's look at the coolant temperature. Let's look at the ambient conditions and the barometric sensor to see elevation and whatnot. And then it will just jump to, okay, full throttle, these conditions, this is how much fuel to add. It's an educated guess, I guess you could say. But then they went to the point where fuel economy standards got more extreme and you need a wide band. Those are your primary 5-wire wide band sensors. So they're useful. You can actually add up to 34% fuel on the N54 because it's wide band. And even if your tuner kind of sucked, they could, you know, you're not gonna blow your motor because this thing will compensate quite a bit and dial in your air fuel ratio anyway, even under load, 100% throttle. So this narrowband sensor is way better at figuring out what a perfect airflow ratio is for stoichiometric, for fuel economy. It will do a better job than this because this is not gonna have the resolution at that exact range. There's not gonna be as many dots of points along the way as there would be here, if that makes sense. These are actually designed to flip-flop between 0 and 1, and then they look at that situation. And if it's more towards 0 while you're cruising, then it's leaner. If it's toward 1 and holding there, then it's too rich, and it'll adjust until it can get to a nice point where it's just going back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, from what I understand. And this will just hold anywhere along the range. So I guess it has to do with the way they signal and transmit to the ECU. So I flashed my new MSD81 ECU and it right away referenced the narrowband sensor for stoic and then said, wait, something's off. And then I said, I can't use this. Have you ever had a misfire on your car? You start it up after a warm restart and then it runs rough. And then all of a sudden it's like the ECU's like, screw it. I'm just gonna smooth out and RPMs go a bit high and then something feels off. Next time you start the car, same thing happens. You get a check engine light because it had to go open loop. It had to disregard the sensor and run like an old school car where it was making an educated guess. And then it's gonna give you a check engine light. So that's what happened with me. But the thing is, I was running on this narrowband sensor in my MSD80 for months and months and months, and who knows how long it's been off. And what it was doing is telling the ECU, hey, everything's fine, I'm functional, and giving the wrong reading. So it was reading off. So then the base, the zero point, the middle point for the wideband sensor, which is calibrated off the narrowband sensor, was shifted. It could have been shifted left or right. So when the ECU is thinking everything's fine and it's running rich, it could have actually been lean and you get a misfire in cylinder 6 or whatever, you know? So these can't be neglected. They're not just there to see if the postcats are working. They're there to calibrate the primaries. They're there for overall fuel economy and they're part of the car. Just like why you can't run the DP fix, downpipe fix for too long. When you press zero on your scale and you tear it to be able to measure weight, that's what this does when you start the car. So you need these. So sorry about the long explanation, but hopefully that makes sense. this is your tear, this is your reference point, and then that calibrates the wide bands. So I'm going to replace these, and then I'm going to reset O2 sensor adaptations in MHD and see how the car runs. I'm going to show you the codes that are pulling up before we go under the car and pull out the sensors. Starting with the generic scanner, we have pending, meaning it's an active ongoing situation, and stored codes. P114B, P0041, P114B is P0041. That one is going to be that the post catalyst fuel trim is too lean. P0041 is a swapped O2 sensor. It's like they think you put it in the wrong downpipe. You know, to be fair, I did get this code as an inactive code that would never actually show up on my dash, and sometimes it'll show up on MHD. So we have O2 sensors mixed up, same thing, and just oxygen sensor emission control, just in general, that O2 sensor is no good. So what I'm hoping to do is put a floor jack here, get the car safely jacked up, and just go from the side and get full access to them. So here we are under the car. Here are the O2 sensor plugs. So I have the left, this bank over here has a gray sheath on it. So we'll pop this out here. The connector you don't have to worry so much about because you can't mix them up. As you can see, it has a yellow ring on it. And you'll know that it only goes on that one plug. There's no way to mix that up. Just disconnecting this one over here. There's this other one here. I didn't have to take the shield off to get access to it. So basically, slide that out. It's got a green O-ring on it. I'm going to remove this O2 sensor here. It's the easier one to get to. As you can see, it's black. So this should be the first pipe going to the front of the car. So there's the one sensor removed. Okay, so I've come to the conclusion that I gotta loosen this downpipe out of the way. At least get it off here to get some flex. So I'm gonna see if I can do that. And then hopefully get to the V-band for this at the top. I'm gonna get this cover removed. I'm gonna see if I can get access to the downpipe V-band clamp to loosen that out of the way. So I don't wanna film this whole process. I'll remove that cover. We'll come back when I'm trying to get access to the V-band. So I recently did my turbos and I was pretty conscious of the way I oriented my V-band clamps for my downpipes so that I could get to them without dropping all this stuff or removing the steering rack. So over here, I was able to undo the V-band without fully undoing it, just enough to get some flex in the downpipe. And then I just shoved a pry bar in between these two pipes just to space them out enough to be able to get my tool in here. I'm just trying to save some time, really. So it's a tough job to be able to get to the O2 sensor over here. But if you just create a bit of distance by undoing those bolts, removing the gasket, and undoing your V-band, you'll get just enough flex in this thing that you can go after it with an O2 sensor tool. There's not much you can see, but anyway, there's my tool right there. So I don't know if anybody's ever shown this method to get this O2 sensor out without removing the downpipe, but it may be easier to say, recently did my turbos, but remove these two bolts, loosen your V-band. Hopefully you'll be oriented in a position where you can get to it with everything in place. Stick a screwdriver in here just to create some gap while you work. And then you can just get barely enough room to do this. So I'll meet you over on the bench now and we'll swap out the wiring. Okay, so we're gonna start with this O2 sensor here. So this heat shield is a little beat up. So I bought this from my local auto parts store, $15, to be able to rewrap that. So hopefully that looked pretty self-explanatory. Now we're gonna slide this into here. As much as it'll go. Bring this over and give it a snap. And we'll slide our sheath over here. There we go. There's one O2 sensor ready to go back on the car. You just gotta match the colors. So there you go. Both sensors are completely rebuilt, ready to go back on the car. And for about $100, even if you had to pick it up at your local auto parts store, you could probably get them for like $120 or so. I'll put a link in the description where you can do it for about $80 for the set versus at least $200 or $300 if you're trying to get them quickly from your local auto parts store. So if you guys don't mind the labor of redoing these, you're saving a ton of money. And if it's one of those things that you want to just change proactively before it gives you problems based on age, might as well do it this way. That way you're not dumping a ton of money in just for general maintenance. So these are ready to go back on the car. I'm going to go into the car and get them installed. And this is already a long enough video, so I'm not going to include that footage. I'll come back when I've cleared the codes and then we'll conclude this video. All right, here's a shot of everything installed and put back into its original factory clips. You can see there's a couple little black square connectors that just stay off to the side, but otherwise everything kind of just looks proper and OEM. So I'm going to go ahead and put the cover back on. We'll go clear adaptations and clear the codes. All right, now that the new O2 sensors are installed, we're going to go clear the DME codes, reset adaptations, lambda sensors, lambda regulation, and everything else is not related.
Now that the codes have been cleared and the adaptations have been reset, I'm going to take it for a test drive, shut it off once, and then restart it again, drive around and make sure that there's no pending codes. I'll let you know how it feels. So that third gear pull felt super smooth and nice. It felt proper. So I'm going to go shut the car off once, drive around for a little bit more, and then when we get back to the house, we'll scan, make sure there's no pending codes to show you that these O2 sensors are working.
All right, guys, we're ready to conclude. As I said early on in the video, I did end up resolving the issue. I have no more codes. Everything's good. But it was my MSD81 ECU that I put in that told me that I had my bank switched on my Postcat. The wires are fine, but it was on the ECU connector side that there was an issue. So just keep that in mind. There's still tons of valuable information in here. If your Postcat O2s are older, you'd want to replace them for maintenance. I'll put a link in the description where you can buy them for relatively cheap and save yourself a ton of money by doing the universal route. So hopefully you guys found this video useful or entertaining. So this is one of those videos where everything didn't go exactly to plan because it's hard for things to go exactly to plan. You never know what could pop up, but lots of valuable information in this video. My issue is resolved and the car is pulling nice and strong. But thanks for watching.